Hotel family, how are y'all today? We're glad that you're here. We are live in People TV, open studio with Dr. Sebi. Of course, most of us know who Dr. Sebi is. If you don't know, I wonder why. You talk about, you know, our great ancestors who left us legacies and allowed us the opportunity to be, if you will, blessed, you know, by those who come along to say that we have grace, that we still can get our bodies right and get our minds right so we can be healed. Now, I use the term healed very loosely because our brother doesn't like to say he heals, and we understand why he's not taking that credit, and we respect that. For those of you who may not be familiar with our brother, I'm going to be very verbatim about it because it's important and it's very, very necessary to take note of who he is and what he has accomplished. He's a pathologist, herbalist, biochemist, and naturalist. He has studied and personally observed herbs in America, Latin America, Africa, and the Caribbean. And has also developed a unique approach to healing with herbs that is firmly rooted in over 30, I believe it's more than 40 years of practical experience. He was born Alfredo Bowman on November 26, 1933. Let that sit a minute so y'all can do the math. Go ahead and add up how many years we talking here. In the village of Ilanga in Spanish Honduras, he never attended school, not even kindergarten. Instead, he took cues on being obedient to the possession of life from his beloved grandmother, Mama Hay. Sebi's mother left her young son with his grandmother to obtain work in another town. His early days of play and observation by the river and in the forest, coupled with guidance from his grandmother, afforded Sebi's foundation to be obedient to the truth in his later life. He came to the United States as a self-educated man who was diagnosed with, I want you to count these, asthma, diabetes, impotency, and obesity. After unsuccessful treatments with conventional doctors, he was led to an herbalist in Mexico. Finding great healing success from all his ailments, he began creating natural vegetation cell food compounds geared for intercellular cleansing and the revitalization of all the cells that make up the human body. Inspired by the personal healing experience and knowledge he gained, he began sharing the compound with others, which gave birth to the Usha Research Institute, Dr. Sebi LLC, and the Usha Healing Village located in La Ceiba. How you say that?
La Ceiba.
La Ceiba, Honduras. Well, that's all in writing. You know, he don't use books. That's right, give it up. Somebody got it. My brother said he don't read books, he don't do all this. Somebody got to do it, right? So we just did it, you know, from there. But there's so much more that we can share with our brother being here. But Dr. Sebi, thank you for being here in Atlanta with us.
Thank you for allowing me the privilege.
Oh, wonderful. It was a beautiful, beautiful event last night, you know, at the Georgia World Congress Center. I mean, most of you who were there are here, you know, and we are live in People TV studios. So y'all let them know you're here. Again, tell them to let them know you're here. All right. Now, I assure you, there's a lot of folks in here. We don't do audience shots, so there's a whole lot of folks in there. You can't even get in the room. So, come on, y'all. So, Dr. Sebi, I want to say thank you. You know, we have talked over the years on radio, RCI. You know, I do radio here as well, so we've been talking for a long time about your journey. Your journey has been a very enlightened one and also a very focused one. You know, you have come to understand the importance of what healing is, and of course that term is used kind of loosely because it's very much, you know, the mainstay of what we call getting well or getting better or being normal, you know, which is supposed to be the healing process. But you know, one of the things I want to probably get you to really, you know, in this time we have, is to talk a little bit about your successes and how you view those successes in light of all the things that people have to work with in terms of the food chain. The food chain is compromised. I just read an article just yesterday where it said that, you know, 80% or 84% of the corn is genetically modified. The soy beans are genetically modified. Everything is genetically modified. But you was giving us information before they even started doing genetically modified. We were talking about the foods were not good for us, period, much less if they were genetically modified. So maybe you can talk a little bit about your journey and your successes. And where do you think we are right now as you continue to allow people to be introduced to your way of transforming or transitioning out of diseases?
Not so much my way, the way. Because I am a recipient of the way also. And last night, as you mentioned, last night was just a surprise to me, and it was for the audience, because I was talking about things that I wasn't prepared to talk about. I didn't edit that in my head. That came out later. I had something altogether different. But about the success rate, the success rate depends primarily on the philosophy that I follow, or the arrangement that I follow. Mm-hmm. See, when I came into healing, the understanding of it, I saw where there was allopathic, there was homeopathic, there was Ayurvedic, there was yin-yang, there was the macrobiotic. But what I noticed that nobody was healing, but they had all these systems. But all these systems, none of them represented me. I'm an African, came out of the jungle. Macrobiotic is Japanese, mm-hmm. Ayurvedic is Indian, yin yang is Chinese, homeopathy is European, but I'm an African. You mean to tell me that God was drunk when he put me in Africa? And when he put me there, he didn't put all of the components that would support my life? No. Everything I needed was in Africa. He didn't put us there and say, well, I'm going to put these people here, but then I'm going to omit a component that support their life in Japan, mm-hmm. that they have to go to Japan and get it. Mm-hmm. No. God doesn't arrange things like that. The Japanese has what they need. The Eskimo has what he needs. And the black man has what he needs. But why is it that being an African, I have to practice the modality of others? Because I have lost my ways. So what I did was to recognize that black woman in the jungle. She had the answer. It seemed as if though, when I talk this way, I'm not connecting when I talk about a black naked woman in the forests of Africa. Yeah? But she's the one that set the standards. She's the one that raised the bar. She's the one that lived in an alkali environment. She is the only one where there is a history showing that she didn't have a doctor and she didn't have any medicines. She didn't have any hospitals. Why? She lived in direct compliance with the life process, mm-hmm. in direct compliance with the laws of life, in other words. Mm-hmm. How could she be sick? How could she get sick? But now today, for us to turn our eyes towards Africa, it is kind of a tedious, because the historians, the anthropologists, the paleontologists, they wrote about Africa in a little funny way.
Yeah,
it was not too palatable.
Right.
So we, our children, mm-hmm. have a tendency to believe in what they wrote about Mama, but not me. Well, I was looking at something altogether different, mm-hmm. because this woman here has the answer. Her environment was alkali. The body needs alkalinity. Mm-hmm. So I began selecting from the forest plants that were not made. Comfrey is made, echinacea is made, aloe vera is made, ginseng is made, peppermint is made, and these, soy is made. These are the very thing that the herbalists today are using. Well, I didn't do that because I had help along the way. Because mm-hmm. I too was indulging in reading these books, these herbal books. And what I found one day, I read Ivan Kirkikov, the Russian, Indian Herbology of North America,
yeah,
with Al Mahajan.
Yeah.
Then you got Myers,
yeah.
And then you have Christopher,
right.
Then you have Culpepper,
right.
Then you have Hippolyta Rodriguez, then you have Jethro Claus. And I look at all these books, and guess what? Mm-hmm. They all have the same prescription.
Mm-hmm.
Something is wrong.
And I want to, because I think one of the things you have said over the years that always sparked my interest, and I felt, you know, that it was so logical. And you talked about Imhotep and how we like to brag about Imhotep being the father of medicine. But you also pointed out that that shows when we really got, when we started getting sick. But who was the first one to be sick? You know, and the reason why we had to have a father of medicine coming out of Kemet or Egypt is because we were the first ones to, you know, to introduce sickness into the world, right?
By the time we got to Egypt, we were sick. Imhotep I was not the wisest man on the planet. Mm-hmm. This man opened the human body. If the human body needed to be open, it would have a zip on it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So he was messing up.
Right. So any incision and
but the Greek who went to Africa mm-hmm. and saw the African swinging on trees, never getting sick, he watched them that they were never sick. But then he noticed that what they were eating was what maintained their health. And that's when he came up, your food shall be your medicine. Mm-hmm. Imhotep I was cool for the Egyptian. But we go before Imhotep I. Our life began long before there was an Imhotep. Mm-hmm. Egypt was already eating ducks. Mm. Egypt was already hybridizing animals. Mm. Egypt became a mixture of Greek, Persian, and African. And this is precisely why Cleopatra couldn't find a black man to marry. She had to go all the way to Italy because she too was one.
Right.
Because Italy controlled Egypt at some point.
Right.
This is the thing about Egypt that is confusing with many of us. Well, with me, it was never confusing. Why? Because I could see realities in my face, and maybe I am interpreting this reality my way, mm-hmm. and maybe so. But this is what I saw. In 1972, every brother in Los Angeles, under the leadership of Dr. Joseph Ben Yochanan, they were going to Egypt. And I was saying, now, what are they going to Egypt for? But they were flying to Egypt. And then when they came to ask me, Brother Kamal said, why don't you go to Egypt, Dr. Sebi? Oh, Sebi. I said, for what? A bunch of stones. But they went. And they came back with souvenirs. But when I went back, when I went to the jungle, I didn't come with any souvenir. I came back with healing.
Right.
I came back with Sia. Mm-hmm. I came back with Kankansa. I came back with Popa. These herbs are electrical. They assimilate. Those who went to Egypt, they came back with these souvenirs.
Right.
Or a piece of rock. Well, who needs that?
Mm-hmm. So let's talk a little bit about your capacity to intuit what was the best herbs, you know, and how you went, when you went to the jungles of the motherland, you were able to tap into that which was necessary for things to help the body to rebuild itself. And that's a gift. I know you can't teach that. You know, you don't know how this is a natural inclination. You know, but it's really interesting that, you know, that we have this sense that, you know, we go through these curriculums and academia to try to figure out how to become herbalists and botanists and things of that nature, when the reality is that if we are innately engaged in that which is our life work and purpose, and we are obeying cosmic law, then we're able to determine what is our role and how we do that, and things come to you as opposed to you going to it. So was that part of what happened when you were able to go and get a sense that, you know, if you look around us and look in our, you know, habitat, that everything was there for us, you know, to support what we have when we fell victim to Western civilization and its diet? You know, that was something that, you know, that you, it was a natural inclination, right?
You know, I never look at it as us being a victim.
Mm-hmm.
What occurred had to occur.
Mm-hmm.
This thing that we called slavery, that wasn't slavery. That was something that had to occur.
Mm-hmm.
It was something
well, shit, that's a good, you know,
because
point
if it wasn't supposed to occur, it would not have occurred.
Uh-huh.
All right? As simple as that. Now, as for me, having the ability to differentiate between what should or should not be,
yeah.
Well, I got that through a whole lot of help. I was born in Central America, and I remember seeing certain things. So when I came to America, I begin comparing what I saw as a little boy with what was now. So I could see that there was a difference. Then being with these black people in New Orleans and in California, I began to develop a different sense of communication with things. But this is what I did. When I would go to Peru, or I would go to Colombia, I would go to the marketplace, and I would ask the woman in the marketplace, why do you use this herb? And they would tell me. I would go to the marketplace in Africa, why do you use this herb? But they would give me these empirical, historical documentation. Well, guess what happened? I would catalog the herb, bring them with me, and send them to Lancaster Laboratories, asking them to tell me what is the active ingredient in these plants. Right. And if that active ingredient doesn't associate, doesn't connect with the disease that they claimed that they were using it for, well, I know that they were in error. But guess what happened? Every herb that I got from those people who we considered natives, indigenous, when the reading came back from the laboratory, they say, yes. The cancansa would affect you sexually. I don't care how old you are, but it has a high concentration of zinc. The other one, which is the sia, they said it has a lot of potassium phosphate. I remove a tumor from Michael Jackson's son's head. Then the other one from Peru, the one that is called the condurango. The woman said it's good for your blood. Well, the woman in Honduras got killed of leukemia. Yeah. But how did they know? I had to send the herb to Lancaster Laboratory because it is the leading laboratory in the world when it comes to biological or biochemical research. How did they know? You know how they know? Just like the gorilla know what to eat. The gorilla doesn't have any nutritionist. But you and I, who went to school, who are educated and civilized, we need a book to eat right. We want to worship God? Go buy a book. You want to see your way through? Go buy a book. Well, how come these people in the jungle doesn't have all that?
Book, right?
Because they are connected. I don't care what degree you may have. If you aren't cosmically connected, you cannot see. You are blind. And you're going to make a lot of mistakes. And I saw many of us do that.
You know, and it's interesting that you say that because, you know, we talk about us being people of the sun and naturally and harmonically we are connected to nature and we really supposed to be tapped in, and we are in large part. A lot of times we have to shut that down and we have to really resiliently resist what we already know because we actually are trying to assume another culture because we think that because we're in Rome, we have to do as the Romans do, or because of our condition, we're forced to take on those things. And we're afraid to go back to mother because it has the connotation of what we have now left as being something that was savage. You know, we were taught that, you know, that it was savagery. But the fact of the matter is that those who actually, who kidnapped those from Africa in divine order, as you stated, knew well that if he kept you far away from that which is your mother, that you will find yourself lost and astray. And I think one of the things that you said that makes very a lot of sense is the fact that when we first were kidnapped and captured, the capturer didn't, and the enslaver didn't say pack a lunch. You know, when he took us, he took us far away from that, and then we got here, and then we began to start to consume, for biosurvival reasons, we started to consume the food that they were eating just so we can survive and sustain ourselves. Now we're at a point where we have to now come back to ourselves, and you're talking about a lot of the foods that we have grown up on. I'd like to talk about some of the things that you have really somewhat shocked a lot of people, particularly when we talk about it in New York. I was in New York when you made the comments on carrots and people wanted to run you out of New York.
They cursed me out.
Yeah, oh, yeah, I was there. I don't know. At that time, I ran a health food store. And we were the only one that was really saying that that was a very powerful position to take And then we began to do our own research and say, you know, well, he has a point. But the point that I wanted to make is that one of the things that happens is that how we do each other, you know, in terms of when we feel that something is not conventional, you know, we automatically are taught, because we've been teaching all along, that the best way to move toward anything is to take what seemed to be logical, like carrots seem to be logical. Potatoes seem to be logical. I mean, what's, you know, why aren't they natural? They're vegetables. Why aren't they natural? But if you really look at it, then you begin to see that it's problematic for the body because it starts and it creates a lot of problems in the body. But when you were in New York, I wanted to make sure people know that, you know, it was a lot more to your making a decision to shift the way that you were allowing yourself to think, is to say that there are people who actually will literally make you an enemy, because you're now threatening their livelihood. When you were in the States and you had that case in 1987, and one of the things I think is important for everybody to know, that it doesn't really come out. And I think that when Dr. Sebi talks about this landmark case in 1987, you know, he just brushes by it, you know, like it's not really significant. But it is very significant. It's very significant because it's a landmark case. That landmark case also allows for you, as maybe one of many, who could say categorically, if you wanted to, that you care, you know, and they can't touch you because of that landmark case. So, you know, cases, when they go into the federal court, they are now used as precedents for moving forward. And no one will stand up and say, well, I'm with Dr. Sebi, because he already has proven in federal court that you can now say that you cure these so-called incurable diseases. And as a result, you have been land-based, you have been, you know, criticized, you have been ridiculed, but at the same time, the evidence is in the results. And your results have been successful. One of the things I want to ask you to speak to in that light is what was your capacity to maintain your sense of focus in the face of all that controversy? Because it was rough.
No, it wasn't rough at all.
No, it wasn't. Okay.
Look, and I could see why you said that, and it must have been rough to many people. Uh-huh. And it seemed that way. But when I am asked now, you are the second person to ask me that question. And guess what? It was recently that I really saw the case and I got scared.
30 years later, right, okay.
If I was conscious, fully conscious, of what I was doing in 1988,
you wouldn't be here now, right?
It wouldn't have been done.
Right.
Because I've been scared.
Right.
But
right.
I was on a vibration of light, mm-hmm. that I was focused on one thing, right. And don't talk to me about anything else. Mm-hmm. So it was that I was driven there. Mm-hmm. I was taken there. Mm-hmm. It wasn't on my own recognition or my ingenuity, mm-hmm. or my scientific ability to dissect and analyze. Mm-hmm. None of that. I don't do that.
Fearlessness.
It was just that I was under vibration because I was put there.
Right.
After the case was won and the burden came back, mm-hmm. I still didn't feel it until about 6 months ago.
Wow.
I said, oh my God. But more than that, I didn't win for me.
Right. It was a victory for the people.
I win for us.
For the people, right.
We, the black people of the world, mm-hmm. have the right to select for ourselves a modality, mm-hmm. that complements our cellular predisposition. Mm-hmm. That cannot be denied of us. What we did prove in 1988, mm-hmm. is that the only therapeutical approach that is complementary to our biological structure is the African biomineral balance, mm-hmm. against all the yin-yang, the macrobiotic, mm-hmm. the Ayurvedic. Man, I don't want to hear that, because I know that they're wrong. They're using starch and they're using lactose.
Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, indicative of and also very akin to those cultures that actually are utilizing it. They utilize it for their makeup, and they're doing
they are right.
Right, and it works for them, but it doesn't work for us. But one of the things that's important about this case, because I was one of those who was in the courtroom, you couldn't even get in the courtroom for that matter, because the courtroom was so packed. But the point is that, you know, the people who were there, this is observers, these are people who were confessing and giving testimonials of the healing. And not just by saying he healed me, like, you know, the Jesus of Nazareth, but trust me, it was like that. People were coming in with all manner of diseases and with proof of what they had from the homeopathic.
That's right.
And they would say, this is where I was after the cellular cleanses. This is who I am. And they couldn't help but deal with the facts. And so I'm saying, you know, that was just astounding. But you didn't get the same type of press you got, you know, in condemning you.
It was horrible.
You know, in that sense, because they were trying to make sure that you didn't get the worldwide press that you needed. But it's interesting that when the judge, and I said this to the people before we got on air, the judge was a woman judge.
Ann Perlman.
Right. After it was over, and the verdict was, of course, in the favor of truth, she said, before y'all leave, make sure I get some of that soul food, you know. And, yeah. Am I lying? Like I said,
she became my patient.
She was one of the
that's
clients.
That's correct.
One of his best clients.
That today.
I'm telling you, and that's a powerful thing. It's a powerful testimony and testament to what you represent and who you are for our ancestors. Can we give it up for that, y'all?
Yeah! Yeah.
I saw a woman last night that I told something to, and she would verify this, and you guys have not a clue what I'm about to say. That case that I won was a powerful case. The white girl who liked me, and I didn't know it, she called me one night about around 8 o'clock to say, could I come and see you? I said, yeah. She came over, Ruby. She said, you did something that has not been done, ever.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
Guess what? They already groomed a young lady to obliterate what you did.
Mm.
What you mean? He said, well, they already groomed a black girl, and they got a few leaders that is helping. And guess what it was? When I won that case, a week after winning that case, what was the most publicized news throughout the United States and the world? Tawana Brawley was raped.
Yeah.
I told Annette.
Right.
Black America never knew that. Tawana Brawley was never raped.
Mm.
But they smothered Dr. Sebi case. But even though they put a lid on it, they couldn't contain it. Mm. But I knew that Tawana was lying. I knew that. Annette knew it. I told Annette a week before, all the leaders in America supported Tawana Brawley. Mm-hmm. Ask them who raped Tawana Brawley today. You say, I don't know. Well, what was the noise about? The noise was about covering what Dr. Sebi did. I already knew it.
Mm.
But I had a mother then that was alive,
right.
And she said to me, look, you did something good, but you're by yourself right now. And it wasn't time. It's time now.
Mm-hmm.
This is the time.
Now's the time. Well, I will say that's a startling revelation in terms of those parallels, because you are exactly right. That was around the same time that did occur, and there was a lot of controversy around that. But to stay on track in terms of what really was going taking place, because subsequent to that, you went on, and this is a lot of things that, because of his humility, he'll talk about people who has come to experiment with your cellular cleanses, but don't want to tell nobody that they're doing it, you know. And one of the cases that I always find fascinating is the Teddy Pendergrass case. I don't know.
Teddy Pendergrass?
Yeah. Now, are y'all aware of Teddy Pendergrass?
Yeah.
And y'all know that? I mean, y'all, of course, the crew knows, but let me just do a brief overview of that, you know, because you and I had this conversation many years ago, and it was startling to talk about the fact that all know that Teddy Pendergrass had a tragic accident where he was paralyzed from his neck down to his feet. Only thing he could do is move his mouth and his head. He found out about his wife, found out about Dr. Sebi, because, you know, he's buzzing all in Hollywood. You know, I mean, he's coming down to the people, but he really is buzzing all in Hollywood, everybody. Everybody know about who he was. So the case that I find fascinating is that Teddy Pendergrass, at that time, couldn't do anything with his body. His body was totally, you know, disabled. He came to Dr. Sebi. And Dr. Sebi, you know, in his humility, and I'm going to speak more for him because he's modest about this, you know, that he didn't even at first charge Teddy Pendergrass. That he knew Teddy Pendergrass had money, so he knew he didn't, you know. He has told Teddy Pendergrass, hey, you know, you pay me when you know, when it's over, when you finish.
And, that's and, what I did.
Oh, yeah, and for enough, sure enough, Teddy Pendergrass started taking taking the compounds, and the way he determined that he was doing well is not just because he began to, you know, started feeling pain. And when he was feeling pain, he began to say that something's wrong with this because he's feeling pain. Now, just keep it in mind, y'all, that he couldn't feel nothing previous to that. Now, he's even feeling pain, so now he is now questioning because he has in his ear Ayurvedic. I think he had an Indian doctor in his ear who felt
you threatened. Remember that? Oh, Deepak Chopra.
I want to name no names, but that's the point. Telling him that, you know, that it was something that was very suspicious, or because Teddy Pendergrass was funneling his money there, but getting no results, no results. But Sebi comes along, says, "I ain't worrying about it. You know, you go ahead. You'll be back. Cause I know." Teddy Pendergrass began to feel and began to start moving around, and he began to start panicking, calling, and even to the degree that he was even very belligerent. And we don't want to speak evil of the dead, but this is a good case, you know, to show exactly why if you don't follow your truth and your ancestors, you may not have your body to continue on this planet. And because that was a great opportunity for Teddy Pendergrass to show that he can come back home and he can also support that which our ancestors, he chose not to. That was a choice he made. You know, but at the same time, he also began to start becoming more sexually functional. So, right? So his, I know the story. You know, because as a man, you know, we got to keep those stories tight in our head, right? So, and it wasn't him that was excited about it. His wife was more excited about the fact that he was. And she was the one like, more, give me some more of that, you know, because they were not previously having any type of intercourse. However, Teddy Pendergrass began to feel pain and began to start saying that, you know, when he was actually now going to the bathroom, he was it was too excessive because he couldn't go to the bathroom either. He was using, he had a little pouch. It's kind of gross. I know y'all getting visuals and stuff, you know, but keep it up, right? So, and he began to not go through this process of feeling that something was wrong because he kept going to the bathroom. He didn't want to go to the bathroom. Now, mind you, you only go to the bathroom when you have to. I mean, if it ain't there, you ain't going to go, right? So now he's going to the bathroom, removing all the mucus and the sludge out of his body, and he's beginning to now feel again. And he began to start saying to Sebi, that man, I can't even sit in my meetings because he wants to have these meetings because he's trying to do music and he feels it's interrupting with his music, so he wants to stop taking the compounds, and he did. Am I accurate?
You're 100% right.
And so, as we know that at the end of that story, you know the end of that story, right? Teddy Pendergrass is no longer with us. But the fact that you know that we don't have enough respect to recognize healing because we don't know what healing really means because we're so busy thinking that we can't do it when we look like each other. And this is one of the things that's embarrassing. I can go so far as to say Michael Jackson, I can go on and on. And there are those who are still engaged in using the compounds because they know it works. Eddie Murphy being one of them. You know, I know that for a fact, that he's also a client, you know. And these people don't talk about it, you know, as Lisa did. And Lisa was getting about to do something that was going to, you know, really take us to another level. And obviously, you know, we know she's no longer with us, unfortunately. But that's part of, you know, your journey. Your journey has been the proof of the pudding, not just, you know, projecting it or speculating about healing or removing things. You did it basic. Get rid of the mucus, your body comes back to its alkaline state. Get rid of the acid, it comes down to the alkaline state, and you begin to start functioning again. Most did not want to, don't want to do that because of the inconvenience, you know, it comes with taking all that stuff out of your body. That's my commentary, my spiel, y'all. I'm a little soapbox. So, can give it up. So if you, facts are what they are, but I really want you, to you have to have a resilience that you have, and Dr. Sebi, and we give thanks for your spirit, you know, and your sense, your knowing, and how you move about. Where are we as a people when it comes to that? Because if all the food is being compromised now, and it's literally compromised, before it was compromised because it was just bad for us, because it wasn't our DNA structure, but this is now totally, you know, being utilized for the purpose of industry. What do we do? How do we move in a way that will allow us to get back to our natural selves and our healing selves?
That's a good question. That's a very, very good question. Because if we're going to make a transition, then how are we going to do it with what? That is why last night I mentioned the $200 million project. That we could begin to provide ourselves with the necessary food, because they are out there. Mm-hmm. You got spelt out there. Mm-hmm. You got amaranth. You got also the quinoa. We have all kind of greens. We could begin to change the diet and modify the cooking thing. We could do it. We have the components. The components are there, and they are sisters that knows how to prepare the food. Like Chef Aki, you know she's very, very good. So she could begin to help us make that transition from where we are to where we need to go. Mm-hmm. The foods are there. They are there. We could connect with Africa. Africa is growing a lot, we call it like fonio. Fonio is one of the most healthiest grains in the world. Okay, we could begin to import that. We could begin to grow the chatter senise.
Spell that, fonio, spelling. How you spell
fonio,
that?
Fonio, F-O-N-I-O.
Mm-hmm. Fonio, y'all got that? Yeah. All right, y'all got phones, fonio.
So, F-O-N-I-O.
Right.
So in Honduras, we are buying land, like 1,000 acres, to grow the chatter senise. It's the natural banana. Starch less. A cereal for the children and for yourself. All these things we have in the $200 million project. We're going to do it.
And the timeline on that, is there a timeline on for that?
Timeline?
Yeah, on making that happen.
Making that happen. Yeah, we say by the end of this year, we would have all the money in place and doing it. Right now, we're building the Lisa Lopez Culture, Science, and Art School. You know, complementary medicine.
Right. And you say that because you owe a great debt to her because of her coming and giving you the love that she has and also the healing that she provided for you. You mentioned that last night again, you know,
yes.
That were not for her, you know, she came to you and said directly, as the mother does,
oh, yes.
You know, that you needed the healing. Lisa Lefi Lopez, you know, TLC, this so y'all, if y'all some of y'all a little younger.
But Wanda, her mother,
right.
Sold me a piece of land.
Right.
You could say giveaway.
Mm-hmm.
With the agreement that we would do something there for children and for the community.
Right. That was the condition, right? That was the condition, huh?
Yes.
Yeah.
I have to comply with that. And I'm glad, because Lisa was a wonderful person.
And she was in Honduras when she met her tragic death,
that's
right?
Correct. Yeah.
Right. And she
that
was there
correct.
Working with you at that
yes.
time, you know, and helping. And she was getting ready to go and let the hip hop community or her, you know, to know about the importance of the cell food, the cellular, right? And unfortunately, we lost that. We can, you know, we conspiracy theorists. I don't know. I don't trust nothing. You know what I mean? But we got to be able to say that everything is divine order and help something to spare her something else, because sometimes we can't do it, you know, while we're on this plane. Her life is really an important one, because she was shrouded in controversy, trying to make her out to be some type of, you know, crazy young sister because of her, you know, relationship, you know, with Andre, whoever he was, you know. But her spirit was so deeply connected to what it is to heal that she was very much regimented on the sea moss, you know, and everything else that she was preparing it. And she was staying, you know, at the Ocean Research Institute.
She were. And she went into a stage and a level of life that we all saw her transition. She saw it. She mentioned it. She was in another vibration. That had to happen. She was beautiful all the way to the end. She told me I was sick, told me I needed healing, and she was right. She brought an energy to the village that improved the village.
Bumped up the vibration of the village.
She was very good. I miss her very much. Lisa Lopez, Lisa Left Eye, left her mark. And we're going to do something for her in the village.
In her honor, right.
So we
give it up for that, yeah. That's great. Right.
But you have a very good memory.
Oh, yeah. You know, I take
you remember it very well, because when Teddy Pendergrass feet was hurting him, that was never supposed to happen.
Why are my feet hurting? Was it hurting last week? You know, but that's the ignorance. You know how ignorance is really. He didn't know, right? Ignorance means to ignore, really, because you know he was ignoring the fact that he was actually on his path back, and he probably couldn't fathom, because he thought that he may have been stricken to that wheelchair the rest of his life, because that's what they tell us, that these things are incurable. They don't realize that you need to go inside or in and see you are able. That's a word sound, y'all. Take the time and do the alphabet. You know, but the point is that it's always an inside job. You know, and I think that what you provide for us, not just to sell you the food itself, but the state of consciousness has to go with that too. You have to know that you can transform any disease.
That's
you know,
right.
The kidney disease, all these things that got us thinking that are, you know, that you have to be tied to a machine the rest of your life. You know, all that is, you have to bunk all those myths, Dr. Sebi. And you know, and to really have you still standing strong, falling on your knees, showing off, literally. You know, you showing off, man. You know, you got us brothers sitting there saying, man, I ain't falling on no knees, not this week. But that's part of, you know, your spirit is resilient in the fact that we have to know that we have the potential. You are a good signpost for what we know we can aspire to be, brother. And I want to thank you for that. And thank you for giving us a living example. Because without examples, you know, we just, you know, it's just conjecture. You know, I hope I can grow up and go old and be 82 and have a baby at 11 months old and that kind of stuff, you know. It's just a thing you dream about, you know what I'm saying? But that's a powerful testament of your strength and your will and what the cell food does, because you are a living embodiment of that.
I got it from you. Again, I was on that vibration, because I am the individual that didn't go to school.
Right.
I'm the individual that didn't have a future. I'm the individual that didn't even care about a future. So why did this happen?
Right.
It was supposed to happen.
It's
as simple as that. Not that I'm wise, because
yes.
I don't have any wisdom. I don't know what wisdom is. People tell me they got wisdom and knowledge, but I made it through and
that?
I missed it.
Yeah, what is that? What is that?
I don't know what it is.
It sounds sweet, though. Sounds good, something good to have. But, you know, at the end of the day, you know, you can't produce what it is based on proof, based on results.
Based you gather information.
Right.
You store it.
Right.
Then you recall it.
And you use it.
That's not wisdom. Mm. But why do I have to store information?
Right.
When I was in the jungle, I didn't have to store anything.
Right.
I was connected.
Right.
I just acted.
Mm-hmm.
And it was on time. Now, I have to read a book. Oh, this, look, so many calories a day. And I need these enzymes. Oh, and what about my protein? Protein?
Right.
What's that?
Yeah, what
I
is
don't
protein?
Know.
Does protein really exist? Does it really
protein?
Exist? What is that?
That's a word.
It sure is.
And everybody thinks it's existent. It doesn't exist.
Mm-hmm.
When I asked Dr. Steinberg at the Washington Pediatric Hospital, Dr. Steinberg, you said that I didn't give a kilo stout any protein. I don't know what is protein. Do you? She said it's one of the 19 amino acids, the building blocks of life. Well, they have these pet, very arranged philosophical answers for you.
Oh, yeah.
I say, ma'am.
Say very arranged.
Just cut to the chase.
Right.
Is it electrical?
Right.
Mm. I don't know.
Look,
hold it.
Yeah.
Protein is your premise.
Mm.
Is it electrical and you don't know? Why do you ask? Because the human body is electrical.
Right. Body electric, right.
The human body is electrical.
Right.
And the food has to be electrical.
Mm-hmm.
You call that chemical affinity for assimilation or digestion. That's why I asked you that, Dr. Steinberg.
You always got to do the pH test.
What's that?
The pH test has to be always applied.
Always above 7.
Right.
But they never talk like that.
Right.
They always tell us pH balance.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, cut it out. Is it acid or alkaline?
Right.
There's no something in between.
Right. It's not black.
So
it's
I asked the doctor, mm-hmm. Dr. Steinberg, since you don't know what protein is, what is sickle cell? Oh, sickle cell is a disease that black people got 10,000 years ago because the blood went through mutation. I said, I am more confused. She said, why? Because my brother, Dick Gregory, was trained by your brother.
Right.
Everything Dick Gregory knows came from your brother.
Mm-hmm.
And he says that God gave us sickle cell to fight malaria. You tell me now that it isn't God. Is mutation. Well, I'm going to tell you something right now, Dr. Steinberg. Sickle cell is neither God nor mutation. It's a deprivation of iron fluorine. This woman didn't know what to do. See, we not doing independent research, they could tell us anything. And we have to accept it. But not now. No more. Enough is enough. We have the answer. Well, we have the answer. We always had the answer.
We are the answer.
But
right.
We didn't know. Right. I'm not smarter than you. I'm not smarter than anybody in this audience. I just happened to be one that was spared to get the information to bring it back. But the information is mine. Mm-hmm. It's already coded in your DNA. It's been there.
Right. Or you just call
because
call
you recognize it.
Right.
When you hear it, you recognize
it. Yep. I mean, you feel it. You
that's
know.
Right. You feel it.
You feel it and knows it, right?
Because you have it in you.
Right. Well, you know, I mean, and that's a good point to make also in terms of us, you know, ignoring some of the things that we naturally or innately know is because we're so busy trying to stay with the popularity of something as opposed to dealing with what's really coming up. So we lose a lot of our capacity to resolve a lot of our issues in our tissues because of that. Right, because all these issues are buried in our tissues, and all we got to do is ignite our DNA, and we'll remove all of those things that we have been somewhat tied down with because of our thinking is in the way of our reality, right?
Well, you know about our thinking is European. Mm. All of our thinking is European.
That's right.
You know, but that's okay, because that's who trained us.
Right.
But guess what? If the conditioning was so effective, mm-hmm. why this message is creeping through?
Mm-hmm.
Why do we have this message now? Right. If the conditioning was as effective as they want it to be,
mm-hmm.
we wouldn't be having this conversation right now.
That's right, that's right. So that means that we should appreciate that we are in grace. That
right.
That there is, you know, an answer, and we don't have to get, if you will, pessimistic about some of our conditions. Even if we talk about political, economical, socially, we have to just stay focused.
That's
and,
right.
And respect our mother.
And stop beating up on ourselves.
Right. Stop beating ourselves up.
And mama,
right.
as you said, she's number one.
Mm-hmm.
She's the one that set the standard and raised the bar.
Right.
People misinterpret her. And we help to perpetuate that myth. No. Mama was impeccable. That's why Mama didn't have religion. Mama didn't have a Bible. Mama didn't have a church. Because Mama wasn't sinful. Mm. Not being sinful, she didn't need to save her soul. Mm. Now we are civilized and we are sinful and we have to pay to save our soul.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, and I think that, you know, everything has to be bought and sold now. That's what's based on the whole world of everything is money. Time is money now. Everything is about, you know, a purchase, you know, and I think that we have been so bought and sold, you know, many times over. Let's do this. Let's do this. I know we have probably, I don't know how much time we have left. You know, maybe my producers will tell me, but I think that we should talk about diseases in the way that you do so prolifically. And that is, you know, if I said to you, Dr. Sebi, that I have issues with my kidneys, I know there's only one disease, right? And you know, and you're already proven
you remember that.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. So when we look at you know, the levels of diseases in the body, how the body actually takes on certain deleterious behavior, because you know, now your kidneys are overworked or they're not working properly or they're being, you know, but then we go and we have to go to these places where they say you got to be on dialysis, you know, and then you're tied to a machine maybe the rest of your life, you know, now you have to go and get yourself cleaned out, as they say, you know, and then put the blood back in. And talk about that, you know, from the standpoint of cellular memory and cellular food and cellular retardation maybe. How is that, you know, so in such, you know, that we are not even able to show, and you have proven it, that you can transform and turn around what they say is a disease that can't be turned around?
You're referring to dialysis.
Yeah, dialysis, right.
I go to Raghunanda. He's the best example yet. Washington, D.C., 1983. Fairmont and 13th Street by Vince. Raghu came. I've been on dialysis for 5 years. Could you help me? I tried. begin the treatment. 2 months later, Raghu is urinating. Raghu is urinating, and he is happy. Raghu urinating this month, next month, the following month, 3 months, 4 months. On the fifth month, Raghu tells me something very crazy. Raghu asked me, Sebi, I want to go to the ashram in North Carolina. I said, Raghu, the ashram, I think that's Indian, isn't it? But you're an African, what you going to do there? Well, you know, I'm a Krishna. I said, but a Krishna being an African, being a Krishna? You mean to tell me an African need India to save itself? I said, do me a favor. When you get to the ashram, don't eat anything that the ashram has to offer. If you do, you're dead. Man, Raghu thought I was joking. Raghu went to the ashram and started packing it in. I didn't see Raghu for 3 days. On the fourth day that I saw Raghu, it was 4 o'clock in the morning. The train rocks at my windows. When I look outside, it's Raghunanda. Sebi, Sebi. Raghu is dying. Raghu has swollen up like a balloon. Raghu didn't believe me. You see, Indian food has polymers that makes up curry, which is very dangerous. And he's coming from a situation that was very, very, very heavy, very stressful. Raghu died 6 o'clock that morning, showing us that we, the African people, we cannot eat Indian food, we cannot eat Caucasian food, because our cellular predisposition was not designed for those things. But nobody came with the truth to us. They take advantage of us. And we being vulnerable, we allow it. We allow it.
So a regimen, if one is on dialysis, a regimen of obviously changing your consumption habits, obviously your diet has to change maybe drastically, and you have to stop, you know, continue to internalize or intake, you know,
that a sensible diet.
Right. But now, what does the formulas do? How does the herb go to the kidneys?
I gave Raghu a composition known as Focus Varicocelsis. It has potassium iodide, it has potassium bromide. What that does is to go into the kidneys and begin to break up all of the crystallization in there.
And calcification, man.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And clean the villi. And there goes urine. And it revitalizes the kidneys simultaneously. Mm-hmm. But the body is going through stress and is weak. But you will be able to recover from it if you continue on the diet. You have to maintain a certain diet, an alkali diet. Mm-hmm. It happened with Miss Emma Wright.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Remember her?
Oh, yeah. Oh,
with
yeah.
The sickle cell?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
In 60 days, not one cell was sickle. Mm-hmm. She went to California, and she started packing it in, mm-hmm. and she went in a crisis. Mm-hmm. We have to understand that there are food designed for us, for our cellular structure. So as we look at this picture tonight, who love us? Who have shown love for us? Is it that they're ignorant, or is it that they just don't care about us? Well, either one. We found out that whether allopathic, homeopathic, Ayurvedic, yin-yang, they all failed us, but the African biomineral balance. And it happened so, it is ours.
And also, even the invasion, you know, because you said about cassava, we eating a lot of cassava, eating comfrey, all those things, you know, we now has been imported into Africa, to the continent, and actually now becomes a part of our staple. But that's not our staple either, cassava.
No! And you know, a little boy, 12 years old, said something to me that was so strange. Dr. Kweku Ando took people to Ghana. And in Ghana, they had a class. And the little boys in the class, the little boy knew me personally. So when Dr. Kweku Ando was talking about cassava and the uses and the benefits of it, the little boy said to Kweku, Dr. Kweku, Dr. Ando, Dr. Sebi teaches that cassava has cyanide and starch. Oh, don't listen to him. Why would that message be afforded? No. So what I'm seeing, that Bolingo has raised the bar, and we have to live by a new code of ethics, because we have been, well, we have not been as responsive to our needs that we should have. But we're growing. I would have liked for Dr. Kweku Ando to take a different position. I'm not saying that he was wrong or right. I'm not saying I'm right tonight, because I'm growing. Yes, we cure AIDS and sickle cell and blindness. That doesn't mean you know everything. Right. We're growing.
And to know everything is to know nothing anyway.
Right? That's right. Right.
Well, I mean, I think that, you know, you bring a great point in terms of us being able to be more patient with each other. I think that that's a problem that
it's
we
important.
Have. It's so important. It's essentially important. And you have proven that over the years, you know, that, you know, I remember you said a little while ago that everybody's right.
Everybody is right.
So, you know, we're getting to a point of having to have this polarity conversation about trying to prove yourself right, because that can kill you, you know, trying to prove yourself right, you know. But at the same time, we all have a destiny that we all should be tied up into, that destiny of us reclaiming our position on this planet as Africans.
I like the way you are allowing this thing to flow. I like the way you allow this thing to flow.
I'm telling you, when I go up,
you allow the information to flow out.
Oh, yes.
I've been interviewed by many, many times, and they put these barriers and they twist things around and they confound the message. Tonight, you let the message flow, something that I've never experienced with many others before you. You are.
Well, you said it, you know, that it's time. It's time for message to flow, and I'm just right on time. Right?
You are it.
but I say that in all due respect, and I'm humbled by that, and I appreciate, you know, the acknowledgement, you know, and only compliments of yourself. And I'm not saying that, you know, just to try to patronize you, because you are very much of an established icon in our community. And I love you. I've been loving you ever since I was in New York, loving your spirit. And, you know, I can say that, you know, as you talk about divine and cosmic law, I always knew this was going to happen. You know, this has had to happen, you know, and I think that it's important, you know, because of the respectability that you have already claimed. You know, yes, last night, you know, that was a testament of your work. You know, to have that Congress hall filled the way it was, you know, I mean, you have to give yourself a round of applause for that, because that means the people are ready and they're receptive and they're ready to listen and hear. You know, when we've been dodging and trying to avoid it. So what we're going to do, because we're running out of time for this segment, we got a little more, we're going to get some of my audience, because I know last night some of you, I heard y'all in the hallway talking about, he didn't do no Q&A. I wanted to ask him a question. So we may get a chance, some of you could ask some questions. Are you willing to stay here?
Yes, sir.
Questions? So we're going to take a quick recess. Y'all can get up and get the blood out your butt a little bit.
All right.
Welcome back. Welcome back, people. We're having a good time. Give yourself a round of applause. We're having a wonderful time here. Not only are we having a good time, but we're being edified and educated, and we're also being enlightened. And that's important for us to really come to a journey. And you talk about 500 years of this journey of us trying to figure out who we are, and the way we figure that out is how we eat. You know, because they say you are what you eat, right? So we have to come to grips and realize that that's a serious statement. And it also speaks to a lot of why we are still crazy as ever and still having all these problems. And because Dr. Sebi has come to say, well, we need to make another decision. We need to, well, make a decision as an acronym for MAD. If you're mad at something, make a decision. You know, change your path so we can be able to get back on, as pathologies are, because Pathology means the study of your path, right? So when you're sick, you know you have a pathology, that means you have to study your path. I know Dr. Sebi said this language is not ours, it's not, but we can make it work, and we can know that there's some spells in that bad boy, so we just need to know that when we learn the language, we have to use it in our best interest until we learn our own language or language that we left. What I want to talk about quickly before we go to Q&A is something that stood out for me as well to show that gave me more confirmation, because I already had enough that you were on the right path. But when you begin to speak about our Olmec, Toltec ancestors, and that is so essential because
the Olmec,
out of Mexico,
there. You know,
and what they have done to prove who we are right now and why we should be the way we ought to be, because they are the ones that really has the answer to a lot of the issues that we have now in our communities, because they held on to the sacredness of our sojourn. This is why, you know, Professor Ivan Van Sertima talks about that they came before Columbus, and he talks about the Olmec civilization over here in this side of the continent, not just Africa, but, you know, to show that we were everywhere, and we are everywhere. But you brought out something yesterday. You were talking about Mexico, and Mexico, we know we talk about the old Mexicans, right? The original Mexicans, right? That's what Olmec means, right? Talk about them in terms of your relationship to that, because you said Mexico was so critical, and that's why they always talk about the Mexican and immigration. Y'all think it's something that, you know, is not what we think it is, but there's something more sinister going on about why they don't like Mexicans and why they don't want Mexicans here, or why they're trying to have this border discussion. And, you know, it's something always deeper. And every time you listen to somebody like Brother Sebi or talk about Brother Professor Ivan Van Sertima, we get reminded that there's something about our ancestors that we don't really know. And they're closer to us than we can even probably even fathom. So talk about, you know, that to the degree of Mexico and its significance and the Olmec, Toltec, and Zapotec.
The Olmec indigenous society was a highly ethical society. It wasn't a society like Egypt. Egypt was a confounded society. It was a society that was built with Greeks, Persians, and Italians. Egypt was not like Mexico. Mexico was thoroughbred. This is why today the descendant of the Mexican has a level of integrity that nobody on the planet has exhibited. Not even the Egyptian in Egypt today exhibit that level of integrity. These people didn't eat corn. They didn't eat wheat, the Egyptian did. They didn't eat cows, they didn't eat hogs, the Egyptian did. The Mexican ate what they call teosinte. When I get home with Marina tomorrow, the ladies right now in Honduras is making some tamales out of teosinte.
Man, can I come?
Sure.
Can I come?
Of course.
Oh, I'm gone out of here.
Look.
Make me hungry, man.
When I go to Mexico now, I always face people that is going to share a level of integrity and morality that you never found in Egypt today nor yesterday. And don't talk about the pyramids, because the pyramids in Mexico, you could put the Egyptian inside of them four times.
Yeah, 4 times. Yeah.
You understand?
Oh, yeah, very much so.
But the Mexican people are so humble that you would never get that from them. They and they alone are the only people on the planet that is cosmically in tune, a Mexican.
Right.
No Egyptian, no African, a Mexican. And to prove that, when I was sick, I went to black herbalists, I went to Chinese herbalists, I went to white herbalists, I went to Arab herbalists, I went to Mexican, 90 days, I'm here 52 years later, doing what that man said I was going to do. When I was 30, I was impotent. The Mexican said, if you listen to me, you will live beyond 80, and you will make babies in your 70s. I said, you out of your mind. I can't have sex now. How could I have it in my 70s? He said, are you going to listen to me? That you do not find in America today among the healers. There aren't any healers in America today that has afforded to anyone That level of healing, Alfredo Cortez did it 52 years ago for me, and I'm sitting back, and I'm waiting for brothers today to show that. No, they sit back, and they begin to criticize. You don't have the you don't hear the Mexican doing that. You know what? I am known in Mexico, Ecuador, Colombia, Peru, by millions of people. Never a negative comment about Dr. Sebi. Call him and you see. But in America, the kryptonites, the urban kryptonites, instead of respecting their mama, they chose to violate their mama. Because when Dr. Sebi won that case, raising the standard and setting the bar, what was they supposed to do? They were supposed to come to me to share with this scientific endeavor, right? Did they come? No, they didn't. No. Because the healers of America today that are black, they are the ones that are compromising the health of the black race, and the white man knows it. That's why they agree with them. I would agree with them too, if I was a white man, because they're writing books and they're talking nonsense, but they are not doing anything that complements the human body. You understand? So the Olmecs wasn't built on the same foundation as these healers that we have today. The Olmec healer, listen to this. I go to Cuautla Morelos, a beautiful place in Mexico. I said, what is that? He said, that's Tila. This is Damiana. I said, may I have a kilo? He said, no. I said, why? No, the man is bare feet. The man is bare feet selling herbs in the marketplace. I want this herb. He could make money off of me. The man said, no, I'm not going to sell you this herb. I said, why? Your license plate on your car. I said, what does my license plate on my car have to do with this herb? He said, everything. Why? It says California. And the best Damiana in the world come from California. Mm. If I tell you this, I'm not being truthful. That you will not find among the healers today.
It's integrity.
In the black community. Yeah. They do not have integrity. So I dismissed them. Look what they said. They told his sister last night when she asked them, how come Dr. Sebi isn't part of the urban kryptonite? Because you guys aren't healing anything. He is the one that's healing. How come he's not part of it? But what the sister didn't know, that a black healer preferred to die than to live the truth. They are lacking of integrity. That man did not sell me that herb because he could not betray himself. This is the level of integrity that we at Bolingo is constructing today around. We are not gonna allow that. I don't care who you are, whether you're my mama or my sister. If you ever make a mistake by telling someone something other than the truth, you're out. Because you have no business doing that. And this is what we are plagued with. We are plagued with people who have yet to behave in that manner. Mexicans, they are number one. They has to be number one. And incidentally, they are the only people on earth that eats a natural food as a staple.
Okay. All right. And I think it's important to point out, you know, that when we talk about the Mexicans and their stature.
Man, they're beautiful.
The stature, you see how short they are. You know, the Olmecs, you know, were also short Africans, as they say they were. But, you know, when the conquistadors came and they invaded, that's when they begin to see exactly how they used to, you know, impose themselves on what we see now to be Mexicans as well. So the spirit of who they are is actually rooted in the DNA of Africans.
They collaborate with me right now.
Because they know who they are.
They just introduced me to an herb.
Right.
That there aren't any black healers in America that knows about these herbs. But the Mexicans came and said, hey, bro, this is what we found. She looked. Boom, 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 boom.
That's beautiful.
Then I would go to them. Right. I said, did you know about this? No. with boom, 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 boom. And we put them together. And we come up with a little project, a product. Mm-hmm. Why? Because we collaborate. I don't get that from the heroes in America. They talk things about me and they say things that are not too favorable. Right. Not too. But that's
well, okay. That's part of the sickness. That's part of the indicative of us being okay. Sick. That's what it is. They need some Viento or something. You know,
that's okay. Now,
they got to pay for
what
it,
they
though.
Did.
Right, they got to pay for it, though.
When they took the position that they took against me,
right.
You know what they showed? Arrogance.
Right. Disrespect. Right.
Because if I set the bar mm-hmm. or raise the standard, I mean.
Clearly you have.
And they're going to offer America a substandard, mm. You know what they're saying? I don't give a damn about my people.
Right.
That is exactly what they're saying.
Right. Because the people need to decide. The people will be your testimony as to who are and how official or authentic or how legitimate you are. It comes from the people, right, people?
Yes.
All right. So, with that being said, I think that, you know, it's always a sad commentary. I think it's our story. You know, I mean, that we've been, this story that you're telling now is the same story that's got us in the now, and it's really not complicated, Dr. Sebi. It really is about us just making the shift and having a code of ethics.
I know you're right. I know
right?
You know.
Code of ethics, right?
And you also know that the Olmecs were black.
Oh, yeah.
I know you know.
Oh, yeah.
And the Mexicans are proud of that.
Oh, yeah. And they made
a big lip.
Yeah. And, you know, and I want to tell you, now you say that, you know, now you brought me there, because they are, you know, I study under the Olmecs in terms of natural time and cosmic law, because they're the one that actually brought the natural 13-moon calendar and calendrix to the world. So the Mayans not necessarily was that. It was the Olmecs that were the parents of the Mayans. But I want to say also, if you notice that in Egypt, you know, when you see the monuments, they got all their noses blown off, right? And the lips blown off and stuff. You see how easy it was for them to do that?
Alexander the Great did that.
Right, but you ever see an Olmec face head with a thing blown up? Because they ain't got that much ammunition. They don't even bother with it. They rather bury it so you don't see it before they can try to obliterate it, you know, with their ammunition. So that's also another sign of knowing that Olmec, and they were wise enough to know so that when it was time for them to discover, uncover, or recover our natural legacy, you would find that the Olmecs, you know, are those, you know, who stood up against all the invaders. And that's why the Mexicans are this focal point. Same way with Haiti. That's why they're the focal point, because they are the warriors who took no mess from any invaders. And we want to give it up for our Olmec ancestors, you know.
Thank you.
But I think as we say that, and we say that sitting here, and most of us don't even know our lineage, you know, to that, you know, and our heritage to that.
We don't see that.
You know, and we don't see it to the degree that we don't realize that we have a connection to them, to the degree that we can really claim that, as opposed to everybody want to claim the slave story. I bet you I can do a survey right now, and most of us would probably think that all of us came through a slave period or the Ma'afa, which is not true. So the point is that are you doing any research to find out what your heritage is and who are your ancestors, so you can be able to have a sense of definitive knowledge as opposed to speculation about assuming that because there was a period of our Ma'afa, the slave period, that we all was not necessarily coming through that lineage. And if that be the case, what is your role, because you now know that? And what do you do with that information? You don't do a juju dance. You know, you decide what you're going to do to support those who are still in ignorance, who may not want to support that which is obvious. And that is, you know, a brother who's doing healing by proof, not just by conjecture. And again, I just can't say enough how much we got to give our brother a round of applause, not because he needs it, because we need it.
We need it.
So now, Dr. Sebi, all that said and done, and you know that you're a firecracker, you know, and you upset people, and people don't feel good around you because truth
upset people.
Yeah, truth make you act like that. So I'm saying to you that, you know, we have, you know, we're in a very auspicious time, because you said last night about the paradigm shift. Now, and that's very much, you know, where we are. You know, we have to change the way that we have been doing things because we can get different results that way, right? How much of that is what you're offering when you go to these cities? I understand that you're on your way to Memphis. Memphis is next. The next stop is Memphis?
Oh, yes.
Talk a little bit about, you know, what your next stop is, because don't leave us here in Atlanta, because we need it.
I love Memphis.
So we all don't want to follow you to Memphis. We want to be able to have something that we can have here. How do we root ourselves in the wisdom, oh, not the wisdom, in the information of Dr. Sebi? See how you get it? Once you get it, you got to shift it. Right. So the information of Dr. Sebi, so we can be able to know that you left your mark here and it's being effective and it's being utilized as you move throughout the planet geographically. What do we do before you go to Memphis? What do we do here as you go to Memphis? Because you already made an impact. As you can see, people love you.
I was telling Mr. G and Rel that we need to open a place in Atlanta. Because what I felt last night was more than I've ever felt in the years I've been doing lecturing. I felt a love that I never felt before. Mm-hmm. Tears came to my eyes last night. Mm-hmm. And it was funny, when the audience got up to leave and I look at them, I didn't see a crowd. Mm. I saw one energy.
Oh yeah.
One energy.
Yes, synergy, yeah.
It was so beautiful that I was overwhelmed. I'm gonna tell you the truth. I was overwhelmed with Atlanta last night, mm-hmm, to show the beauty.
Oh yeah, we the it. You know, and I ain't from Atlanta, but I'm gonna say we are the it. You know, we are the place, we the stopping ground.
This is why the Russian that's in the village now,
right,
asked me, why do black people have leaders? Mm. I said, I don't have one. Mm. I came up my mama and that was it. All right?
That's right.
He said, because I tell him, because the leaders in America have misled and continue to mislead people. Mm-hmm. This is why, in the healing fields, I am a living testimony, mm-hmm, as to what a Mexican could do. There isn't one black healer in America today that have done for anyone what Mexican did for me. So when I talk, I want to talk on a level that we could raise our present position, mm-hmm, because it's not too cool.
Right. Well, you know, the vibration has already been raised, though, Dr. Sebi.
But last night.
Yeah, it was phenomenal.
I felt you guys last night.
It was phenomenal.
I have to come back to this place.
Please do.
But I'm going to Memphis on the 21st of March.
Oh, yeah.
And Memphis has given me another level of vibration that I remember and I love. Mm-hmm. So we're going to Memphis.
Yeah. Memphis is the scene of the crime. That's where they kill.
You're going to Memphis.
Yeah.
My sister.
Kill out Dr. King.
Yes.
And they need a vibration raised over there as well and get some healing over there so they can know exactly how sacred that is, because he gave his blood on that soil, you know. So, again, but yeah, that's right. Give it up for that, right. But again, you know, we want to know. I know that I did a little hodgepodge there, but I really want to come back to a little bit, because we're going to have some Q&A in a little while, because before you know, I'm going to be getting those signs from my producers that it's almost over. But I want to be able to, you know, make sure we clear. People may be listening and watching for the first time, don't know anything of you, you know, and we need to make sure that people realize that we're not just having this conversation with a kook. And maybe so, maybe it is, you know, because we need kooks in our lives so we can get right. But the point is that there's something that we need to talk about in terms of people really who are out there really suffering from disease and illness and ailments. And they really truly are suffering. And that suffrage is really it's hindering them from being a part of the collective so we can get to our liberation, our self-determination. And that we need everybody. Everybody is needed. So when you say you've seen one line or one energy, one synergy, that's so essential to us having a critical mass to turn this thing around, right? You know,
that's right.
And when you're seeing that audience out there, you're seeing that this is part of that critical mass that you want to do, particularly with your project of the $200 million that you think we need in order to pull us over, which is really pennies, is pittance, you know. I mean, it's not a lot. $200 million ain't nothing. I think that, you know, is it $400 million or $200 million?
$200 million.
It was $200 per person, something like that, you know?
Yes,
you know?
Exactly.
I mean, that's really pittance by far. You know, we've been $200 on cable. Y'all know y'all do, right? So the idea or your phones, your gadgets, you know. But I think that it's important for us to talk about the healing for our audience. You know, our audience, you know, is the people. This is People TV, you know. And for full disclosure, I'm the president of People TV, and I really am honored to be that. You know, I want to say that, you know, that having this at our helm to use it as an access, as it's supposed to be, because it's public access to reach our people who are watching this, the elders who are watching this, who are ill. There's probably some 80-year-old saying, he 82, You know, and they probably suffering, wondering how you got to 82 and you're doing so well and so prolific and so strong. So I want to be able to try to, you know, maybe as brief as we possibly can, I know it's difficult to be brief, to talk about these other diseases. You know, and when you say you cure cancer, it's not just something you're just throwing out there. You literally have rid the body of cancer. We've been taught and we've been said that cancer cannot be cured. They got cancer institutes, they got pink months where you wear pink, breast cancer. You know, all this is going on, but you have also shown that you can eradicate disease from the body. Cancer is one of them. AIDS was the biggie. You know, when in the 80s, AIDS was one of the major ones that, in fact, most of the assays that came in the court was about AIDS. You know, when they were first getting the HIV or whatever the case may be, and they were showing the T counts were low or the T cell counts were low, and when you gave them the cellular food, they had a couple of weeks, they came back and went to their doctors, because the whole thing is that when you go to Dr. Sebi, he don't tell you to start going to your doctor. He says, go to your doctor and let him take the test and then get your result. Don't tell him what you're doing. Don't tell him what you're doing. Just say, and they think it's them, you know, and they'll look at you with raised eyebrows, but that's what was happening. You had the actual diagnosis that said that you are HIV positive, or you got the AIDS, or you got cancer, or you got sickle cell, and when Dr. Sebi gives you whatever the cell food that he's talking about, the formulas of our ancestors, you know, then you come back and you go back to the same doctor, and they start saying, well, your T cell count is going up. You know, so the point is that we need to let people know that if they really truly love themselves, as they should, that they will want to seek out that which is going to be effective and gives them results, as opposed to them being tied to pharmaceuticals the rest of their life, thinking that this is what they have to do because this is how you deal with the diseases, because they don't have no cures, because they're inept, they're incompetent, they can't cure disease. So when we talk about cancer cells, the mitosis, right?
Uncontrolled mitosis.
Uncontrolled mitosis. So that's something that you have also effectively dealt with, because talk about mucus. Talk about why mucus is everywhere. Talk about the blindness is mucus. That's that on the eye when you have what's the eye disease, y'all? Glaucoma. Thank you.
Glaucoma.
Right.
Cataracts.
The cataracts. Right. You know, that's mucus on the eye. If you got, you know, cancer of the lung or whatever lung, that's mucus on the lung. You know, if you got bronchial whatever, that's mucus on the lung. If you got kidney disease, all this is the one culprit is mucus.
Correct.
And all you do is take the cellular memory of the organs that come from our geographical location, and it goes and it targets the mucus, cleans the mucus, and then also at the same time rebuilds the cells.
That's right. So you're the doctor.
I really had a question, but it was a question, but never got to the question mark.
But you answered it.
Yeah, I did. I asked my own question. The answer is in the question, right?
But it's beautifully done.
Yeah, but I'm saying that that's just like, you know, it's logical. You know, it's not really something that's complicated if you just think about what you're talking about. Because most of what we eat acidically, or whether it be, you know, mucusy, it's all about things that's piling up and laying on these organs, hindering the electricity. Because that's what mucus does. It breaks the body from continuing to fire the electricity. Right? I mean, I study.
You should join the urban
Christian. No, y'all can't afford me. No, hell no.
Yes,
they put me over there. No,
you should
gonna
join
do
them.
Yeah,
Sebi. Tell them exactly what you just told
I'm
me.
I'm going to
show them that.
I'll tell them Sebi.
Because what they are doing is compromising the community.
Yeah.
We don't want that anymore.
Right. I hear you. I mean, you know, if you're an elder, if you tell me to go over there, I'll go. You're talking about infiltration.
We don't
I know
need
how to
that.
Infiltrate. In the best interest of our people, we need to learn how to do that too, right? So the point is that, yeah, you're right. I think that it's important for us, you know, to stop playing the games, stop derailing, and anybody who is antithetical to our issues of moving forward can be suspect as being a provocateur or an infiltrator or a hinderer to our liberation. That's just plain and simple. You know, basically we're dealing with logic. So, brother, you know, I don't need to go over there because I've been independent most of my life and I don't need the drama. But I'm saying to you, I will go on the record and say that I know firsthand of your work, because I've been following you ever since, you know, you have come to America in the 80s when you were in the 80s, back in the 1900s, right? You know, when you were in...
You were very young.
I was a baby. This is really designer. I'm still young. This is designer white.
You're very young, I said. I said very young. You're still young.
I'm still young, right, as you are.
You like
right.
Mr. G.
Right, yeah, Baba G, right. But I'm saying to you that, you know, I learned early because I ran a health food store at a young age, you know, so I was, you know, in my early 20s when I had a health food store, and we would carrying and dealing with some of your product. We're the only one that would do it, you know. Or, you know, because everybody was like, "Ah, oh, that's not true," you know. So I'm saying that we need to make sure that you get the representation that you require, not because you desire it, but because it is yours to have because of your proof. As you said, you set the bar. You set the, you know, the level of us having to go up against that. What do you think is going to be important for us if we understand the significance of your arrival, your presence, your presentation? What is it that we need to do? I mean, what is it? If you were to give us instructions, I know you like to say that you don't do that, I'm not me, but I'm gonna ask you specifically for instructions. What can Atlanta do as we say you're gonna build something, we should build something here. What are we gonna build here? What is it gonna be that
we're gonna build? A health center. Where in that health center, all of the components that you need to revitalize the body would be there. The food that you need to eat would be there.
We grow our own food.
That's right. They would be right there. That's why Mexico play a very important role.
Right.
I could go to Mexico and get teosinte. I could go to Mexico and get a plant known as estafiate. The herbalist here doesn't know what that is, but it is a rewarding piece of material. I could go to Mexico and get the lily of the valley. The only herb in the world that has two active ingredients. These are the things I'm going to share with the sisters that we are selecting to be the representative of the African biomineral balance. Because I repeat it now, I'm not a healer. A male cannot be a healer. It's a female. So whenever a man come tell me that he's a healer, I know he's lying. It takes nurturing. I cure AIDS, I cure sickle cell, but that doesn't make me a healer. It's much more than that. So we want to do something in Atlanta and in Chicago and in Memphis and in Detroit and in Los Angeles and in New York that would represent that which really is complementary, not alternative.
Right. Beautiful. Can we give it up for that? Yeah. So I think, can I get a time check for my peeps? Where my producer's at? So I know exactly how much time we have before we start doing Q&A. And this is live, y'all. We can do this like that. You know, this ain't, when you own it, this is how you do it, right? So we got Mike. How much time we got, Mike? Oh, cool. Y'all want to ask some questions?
Yeah.
All right, let's do it. Line up around. Mike is up, over there. Mike, our operations person, is going to let you know how to do that. So come around. Don't come in front of the camera. Don't try to, you know. Eclipse us up here, you know, go all the way around that way. And ask your question, let your question, and please let your question not be a commentary. Let it be a question so we can get more questions. And Mike, are we getting calls? Are we able to get calls too?
Yeah.
Okay, good. How you doing, brother?
I'm doing well. Hello, Dr. Sebi, it's good to see
you.
because you have raised the bar and you set the standard so high, I really don't want to study with anybody else. My spirit's on a similar path, similar journey, and I want to do something very similar.
I can't hear you too well. What happened to the mic?
Yeah, that mic is for us to record, but as I'm going to tell you what he said. I heard him. He says that he don't want to study with nobody else. He wants you to be the person that he studies with or under, and his spirit is telling him that's where he's at right now, and he wants to. Is there a question to that?
With
how?
Absolutely.
How?
And what's my advice? What should I do? Where do I go from there?
Well, the Bolingo Project divided into two segments. One is the healing part, and the other is the electric organic agriculture department that we will be doing as males. I would love to do that with you, my brother. Of course I would, because we know that what we're offering is what we need and that we never had it before.
That's right. Give it up for that, yeah.
Okay, you will.
Thank you, brother. And I'm sure, you know, brother, Dr. Sebi's team is here with him, so you can get with one of them, and they'll tell you exactly how you can follow up. How you doing, brother?
Talk a little loud.
My brother, how are you?
Okay.
It's good. Thank you for your energy. Quick question. Let's take a vegan that's a power lifter or someone that's an athlete. What's your take on products such as, you know, diatomaceous earth, chlorella, probably like black rice, not the brown rice, white rice, but the black rice, and maybe like bee pollen and things like that. Certain stuff that, you know, that's
bee pollen.
Yeah, bee pollen.
Okay, B. Pollen. Mm-hmm. Today and yesterday, I share a honey mm-hmm. with some of the people in the audience. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's an alkali honey
mm-hmm.
that you do not find in America.
Okay.
Why? Because the bee that makes the pollen that you're talking about mm-hmm. is a hybrid animal. Right. Okay. It goes in a box. That they prepare for him.
It's a farm, baby.
If you take a pH of that honey, mm-hmm. the pH is 4.8.
Okay.
If you take the pH of the honey that I gave the people last night here, Mr. G was one, mm-hmm. it's 9.8.
Right.
So the pollen from that bee is alkali.
Okay.
And they call that Morocco. Mm-hmm. The mole is a black bee.
It's different than
the black rice. The black rice, that is something made by Chinese.
Okay.
We don't want that.
Okay.
That's acid.
Okay.
Corella, that's artificial also.
Okay.
So all three that you mentioned mm-hmm. are hybrids.
Okay.
No good.
Even the diatomaceous earth?
Which one?
Diatomaceous earth.
Diatomaceous earth?
Yeah.
What is that?
It's basically like it has silica, 70% silica.
It
comes from an ancient seabed where a particular species of it's a type of bug. Can someone help? Does anyone know about diatomaceous earth? Yeah, that's it. It's like fossilized shells that have sulfur, and it's not a hybrid. I just heard a lot about it, but I'm curious to see what you thought about it, if you heard about it. It's
When we finish here, we will respond.
Yeah, research
to that.
Okay.
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 Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. But where's the origin?
I'm sorry.
Where's the origin out of where?
It comes from the sea, the bottom of the seabed. So it comes from an ancient at the bottom of, like, I think 5,000 years ago, this particular fossilized, and now you can.
You see, when something is fossilized, it's a, what you call an oxide.
Yeah,
right.
You
right.
want a vegetable state.
Right.
That's what I wanted to say to talk to you after the speech, after the talk.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
We don't want oxides.
Okay.
It's like some people take seashells
right.
and grind them up for calcium.
Right.
But that's an oxide. It's dead.
Oh, I got you. Right.
You want calcium from the plant, from the ocean.
Mm-hmm. Alive.
Mm-hmm. Sea moss.
Alive, right.
What about shilajit? Like shilajit.
That's right. Chondrus crispus.
Okay.
And they're good.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate that. Thank you for your help.
Thank you, sir.
Next.
Greetings, Dr. Sebi.
Raise your voice out so I can hear you.
All right. I was at the lecture last night. Thank you so much for this message around self-love and love of our community. And I really want to ask you about water, because when we think about our community, right, and we're using tap water to cook with our food, and some of us may not necessarily, not coming from a poverty mindset, but from a reality of lived experience, some people may not have the resource and the ability to afford alkaline water, right? So can you talk about some practical solutions for us as we think about how we have to bathe in this water, brush our teeth in this water that's coming out of the tap system, cook with this water? What can we do to transmute this water that we're cooking with so that we can raise our vibrations for our body's health?
I would recommend us to buy distilled water to cook with.
Okay.
Not to drink.
Okay.
To cook with. Mm-hmm. Because distilled water has a pH of 7. It will rob you of your minerals. To drink the water, the glacier is good. Mm-hmm. Perrier is good. Mm. Anything that is done by Mother Nature. If the alkalinity is being obtained through a process of osmosis, it's no good. It will injure you
mm-hmm.
because they have done it mechanically.
Mm-hmm.
You want nature to do it. This is why in the village in Honduras, Mr. G was saying to me tonight that his knee, he had to go and see a doctor for years with his knee that was paining him. So my daughter told Mr. G to go get in the thermal water. And Mr. G could not believe how could this water do all of this. Because of the level of oxygen. Water needs to have a high level of oxygen. What we intend to do in the $200 million of the Bolingo Project, we buy a refrigerated boat to do what? To bring from Honduras the water we're talking about, to supply this region, the west and the east, the north. Yes, water is important. Very important. Thank you.
And there's also some information that I'm going to share with you before we leave out. There's a sister here who could probably help you with that. I mean, because we got some good, we have other people who are doing some great stuff, you know, so we'll talk about that before we leave.
Okay.
Next year. Thank you, sister.
Greetings, Bubba.
My brother.
Respect.
I think I know you.
Yes, we do. Good to see you.
Yes.
I just a two-part question, but very brief. What, and I apologize if I'm asking something you spoke about because I
That's
got late.
Okay.
What would you recommend for people who are growing food in the city? What kind of food would you recommend for us to plant? And the second part of the question is, many people have shared with me the thought that it's almost like an abomination to Mother Nature for me to live in Atlanta, for to say, and let me send to Nigeria or Mexico or something for some food, because the thought is that nature always provides everything that people need in the locale. So how would you respond to that? How do you feel about that?
Well, if you equate us with this environment, I don't think it would be correct, because we are not from this environment. We are from the African continent. That's why we have to bring things from other places that correspond with our DNA. Are you talking about growing food?
Yes.
Guess what? Do you know I have to go back to Mexico again? Do you know that the Mexican people are the only people that produces an organic, 100% organic fertilizer? Yes, the Mexicans. And that's what I'm using in Honduras now to grow my food. Mexican organic fertilizer, free of the aluminum, free of the other damaging minerals or metals. Yes, it could be done. But again, we have to bring the family together in a collective way to share information. I travel a lot, but it's only me. Now it is Orel and Mr. G. And there is Marina now. And there are Jordanos. And there is Yesenia that makes up the Bolingo family right now. Right now. There will be more tomorrow. But then I have to be careful in selecting people that are going to be members of this particular family, because we were taught about integrity. We talk about morality. I cannot build anything with sick people. I could build with sick people because I'm one, but not when you're very sick. But what you ask is important,
power, right?
And that we're gonna bring to America everything that you talk about.
Right.
Yes, we can. Thank you, my brother. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Any more questions for the brother? I think we got a couple coming up now. All right.
Hello, Dr. Sebi.
Yes, sir.
Great to meet you.
Thank you.
I've been following you for about 25 years. My question is, Dr. Sebi, is it possible to be rich and wealthy without destroying the environment?
That what?
Is it possible to be rich and wealthy without destroying the environment?
Yes.
And if it's so, possible. Could you tell me how?
Thank you.
Okay, good. Next, another question? Come on, bro. Yeah.
Peace and blessings. I'd like for you to elaborate on melanin, on how we can maintain it, keep it healthy, and the importance of melanin as far as African Americans. The reason I'm saying this is because I'm familiar with some people who are actually doing some work with it, but when I talk to the average everyday person, they don't know what the importance of it is. And I guess another thing I was thinking about was the importance of magnesium. And
magnesium.
Yeah, so if you can just touch on those two, you know, I'd appreciate that.
Magnesium is a very important mineral. It's a mineral that addresses the central nerve system especially. Magnesium also works with calcium to strengthen the bones. But when we talk about magnesium, magnesium is found on the planet, expressed on two levels, one oxide, one fluorine. meaning that the oxide is the rock that has magnesium. Fluorine means the plant that has magnesium. So naturally, we will consider the plant because it has what? Carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. It's alive. The magnesium is alive now. It would assimilate. Yes, brother. Next question.
And before you, let me just do this phone call first, Bob, before. We got a call, Mike. Yeah?
This is live.
Yeah, it is live. Oh, yeah, in living color.
Hello, this is Patricia Creighton. How you doing, Brother Shabazz?
Hey, Patricia, how are you? Thanks for calling.
And Dr. Sebi, I am so honored that someone texted me to tune into the show tonight with all the knowledge that you have. And you spoke about bio-mineral balance, and I wanted to know more about that. And they put up your email address, so I'm going to go to that also. But I just wanted to hear about the bio-mineral balance.
The bio-mineral balance. I want you to expound on that a little bit.
Expound on the bio-mineral balance. You know, I don't like doing this tonight because I shouldn't be the one addressing this. This should have been addressed by the healers who are in Atlanta for the last 100 years. So tonight, we have to dispel the myth. We have to address that which should have been addressed already, because it only means that the race was suffering. The biomineral balance, the African biomineral balance. It's a therapeutical approach that considers in addressing pathology on two levels. The intracellular chelation, meaning?
Those are big words, man.
We are going to clean not only the cells. We're not only going to clean the organ, mm-hmm. but we're going to clean the cells that makes up the organ to ensure that the organ is properly taken care of and will function for the rest.
Because the organ regenerates itself. Once the cellular,
of course.
The cellular seat is back in order, then it will take its own course and do its natural healing.
Correct.
Right.
And this is precisely why I want to make you all aware tonight of something that you guys may have overlooked and may not might have noticed.
Right.
But on my products, it says natural vegetation cell food. There aren't any other product in America that could advertise such a thing. Ours are the only cell food in America. Mm-hmm. Well, if you sell something other than a cell food, what are you selling?
What are you selling? Right.
You're selling nothing.
Right.
Because it has to assimilate.
Right.
The other part of the bio-mineral balance, beside the cleansing, is revitalizing mm-hmm. the cells of the body that has been eroded by the presence of the disease right. that you so beautifully talk about, the mucus covering groups of cells. Mm-hmm. When the mucus covers these groups of cells,
kill the electricity.
They erode. They go to what you said, mitosis. In removing the mucus, we have to have this group of cells to regenerate again. If they're in the lungs, we're talking about sulfur. If it's in the bones, we're talking about calcium. If it's in the brain, we talk about carbon and copper. If it's in the prostate gland, it is zinc. So we have to understand the ABCs of healing to properly address a disease. That is the African biomineral balance.
Well. What you say, we got a few minutes left. Make sure your question is succinct so we can make sure we get the answer. If not, our brother's going to be here. When we go off, you can still have the question answered maybe afterwards, but it'd be good for you to ask it quick. Okay, Bob, ask your question.
Okay, I just have a real quick question, Dr. Sebi.
Speak up.
Yeah, raise your voice.
You did say that you wanted to come back to Atlanta.
Yes.
I think everybody in here has the same question that I do, because we would like to see you here constantly. And I'm just wondering, what are you doing in June of this year, like the second week of June?
Cause and see his people.
I want to invite you back to Atlanta, and so whoever I need to see, I want to know exactly who I need to see. I talked to a couple of your people last night. That's my question.
Thank you, Bob. And that's a good question, but you can always see his people. His
brother, thank you.
That's a great question.
Thank you, my brother. I love you, man. I like your image.
Come on, buddy, thank you. We're running out of time, or clock time, that is. Go ahead, buddy.
Yes,
folks.
Dr. Sebi, my quick question. I'm part of the one half of a family that's expecting a new life. We're expecting a baby now. And you're speaking on us being of African descent, dealing with the foods and everything that is according to our DNA. So what would you recommend for a family who's now expecting in order to get the nutrients that the child needs, even in the womb, on the cellular level,
right,
for us?
Well, I just got a little boy born, and he'll be a year next month in March. And I have a little girl, 4 years old. You know, she'll be 4 years old next month, Taiwa. Naturally, with the little understanding that I have, I will share it with the mothers. Iron, that's all. Don't worry about the rest. Iron. She could take iron, and drink sea moss. And time to have the baby, she gonna stand up without no pain and deliver that baby in your hand, because I did it many times with my wives and my babies. It's easy. Don't worry about it. This is why we want to come to Atlanta. And Lisa Lopez's brother and her sister would like to collaborate in developing this holistic
family.
Not holistic, that's crazy. Because holistic medicine offer all kind of garbage. Complementary center, right? And right there, we share information like this with your wife. And there would be other ladies there sharing with her. That's what we had in New York.
Okay.
It was so beautiful.
All
we want to bring it to Atlanta.
Thank you, my brother.
Love you, man.
All right.
Love you.
And we can do holistic with a W, because that means a whole list I see, a whole list of stuff we need to deal with. So we do the W in front of that holistic so we can make it make sense. Go ahead,
Dr. Sebi, the question is food, dealing with the foods and stuff. I know you've done your research as far as pH and so forth and what we should ingest, but my question is, how do we identify some of the foods, you know, independently of, you know, coming to you constantly with updates on the, I think it's a information sheet that you put out?
Yes, sir.
So how do we begin to independent research, basically.
Okay, all right. You want to answer that, or you want to wait?
You know.
We got 3 minutes, so you know, we got 3 clock minutes. So you know how, so go ahead.
To do independent research, this is precisely why I said we need to open a center here.
Okay.
That when you come, we could share information, right? How to go about doing the research,
mm-hmm.
like buying certain, like a pH tester,
right,
a litmus paper. And you could begin to test it, but you have to go through a process of getting the right culture.
Right.
All right? But we could do that for you.
Right.
Okay?
And you know what? And I want you, I'm sure, but that we got the camera on these people who are asking these questions and see exactly how active they're going to be, you know, with that, what she's given as a solution. So we're going to, you know, got you on record, and we'll be going back to the videotape. You know, when people say they want, you know, these answers and they want to get engaged, that's fine. Thank you, brother, for your question. We appreciate it.
Brother, thank you very much.
Hey, Dr. Sebi, quickly, before you leave, we really are running out of time, but I want to ask this quick question. You can answer it, you know, briefly. But the prostate, and you talk about the prostate with zinc. So therefore, any issues with prostate, whether it be cancer, whether it be all these issues that we have, men have, in terms of the virility, you know, or the impotence, you know, mostly you were talking about rebuilding and reinvigorating the zinc intake, right?
Zinc is necessary.
Right. Is that the primary source that you should pull from, or is there any other source you should pull from?
No.
Zinc is it.
That's it.
And done. So listen. Zinc, here we come. All right, so I want to say, Dr. Sebi, thank you for your love, for your time, for your energy, for your support of the people, and for answering your call and being obedient to that call, and to really, truly, for supporting us. And we appreciate you, and we appreciate your love. Can we give it a round of applause for our brother, Dr. Sebi? You better than that, y'all. Love you.
All right. I want to thank you for everything, and more than that.
Thank you, brother. All right.